joined by Assemblywoman Sandra Galef from the New York State Assembly. We've come quickly from our initial meetings, and I'd like to tell you this will be a rather brief meeting. There are items that we will cover, including but not limited to some putbacks by both the Assembly and the Senate that affects dramatically villages and towns in the state of New York. I think that there was a very much of a team effort by both the Assembly and the Senate. And there will be other remarks made by Assemblywoman Galef. But I would also like to introduce to my right, also representing the Senate, Senator Jim Gorin, Senator Andrew Granatis, and Senator Robert Jackson, and Peter Harkham, who's the alternate. The recording secretary for the Senate will be Joseph Foskett. And we will also be, for those who are new to this operation, the general government and local assistance covers a number of different agencies, including but not limited to the Division for Alcoholic Beverage and Control, Department of Audit and Control, Division of the Budget, which we've eliminated, and no, I didn't. the Executive Chamber, Joint Commission on Public Ethics, and the Department of Financial Services. Assemblywoman, if you want to continue from there with the other.
Okay, we have some other areas that we do cover, and then I'm going to backtrack a little bit, but Office of General Services, General State Charges, the Office of Inspector General, the Department of State, Department of Taxation and Finance, Division of Tax Appeals, Office of Information Technology Services, Local Government Assistance, and the Statewide Financial System. And I'm looking forward to working with all my colleagues as we take the second step. Yesterday we took the first step in adopting, well, maybe you would say the governor took the first step to introduce the budget. We took the second step for each of our houses to adopt our budgets. And now we need to work together. We need to compromise. We need to come up with a good financial plan for the state of New York for 2019 and 2020. And we need to do that before April 1st. So those are our goals. And we look forward to working with everybody in that effort. I'm very pleased that a number of my colleagues are on this committee. Fred Thiel, to my right, to my left, actually, sorry. Ken Zabrowski, Ed Bronstein, Billy Jones is an alternate. Catalina Cruz is an alternate. And then, Phil, would you like to introduce, well, Phil Palsamo. You can introduce yourself if you want to. And Gary Finch, who's an alternate that is not here today. And the recording secretary for the Assembly will be Tanisha Young. And I don't know whether your senators have comments.
First of all, I'd like to introduce, who isn't here, but the members of the minority who participate in this committee, Mike Rasenhofer, Patty Ritchie, and no stranger to the New York State Assembly, Senator Jim Tedisco. Okay. Would anyone like to make an opening statement? Okay. Wave, Jim.
I don't have a mic, but I can.
I thought you carried one with you.
In our house, wow, yeah. The majority is good. You know, they really can get things done. And our house is always very concerned about unfunded mandates. And of course, we were very concerned about the fact that we passed the early voting days, the 9 days without funding in the legislative proposals. And I think the governor has no funding in his budget, I believe, for early voting. And the Senate bill, which was passed, their single house bill, had, I believe, $10 million in it, and a combined assembly had $34 million in it. And as I checked and we checked through our minority council with the State Board of Election, they have contacted the city, and just in the city alone, they talk about $100 million for 9 days of early voting. So I'm not quite sure what we're going to have to do, but I know that $10 million or $34 million is probably not going to be enough. And probably the right thing to have done would be contact all the counties in the city early on and get some of their estimates or maybe have a hearing on it. But I want to enlighten everybody from my conference and from our concern that we really don't want that to be an unfunded mandate for this November election coming up. And that's something I think we really have to consider when we finalize the budget. So that's just one of our big concerns.
Thank you, Senator Tedesco.
All right, now I'm going to turn to Fred Thiel, who has a statement.
Very short statement, but as the chair of the Assembly Local Governments Committee, certainly a big focus of ours during the One House budget process was the AIM funding and the cuts to AIM funding for towns and villages, which would have impacted 90% of those towns and villages across the state. This was an issue that I was pleased to work with my colleague on the Senate side, Senator Gorin, who chairs the Senate Local Governments Committee. I think the restoration of AIM was across the board, both houses, bipartisan, and I think it's something as we begin this process that the Senate and the Assembly agree upon, and I look forward to continuing to work with the Senate and my Assembly colleagues to make sure that AIM funding is restored for our towns and villages in the final budget. Thank you.
Also briefly, I chair the committee on banks, and we deal with a lot of the financial services and student loan issues. And from the Assembly Majority perspective, we will be handling some of the student loan issues at a committee meeting as soon as next week. And we'll be working with the Senate and the executive on some of those issues and also trying to figure out ways to give our student loan borrowers around the state some information, some expertise, and some people to appeal to when they have unfortunate situations of missing payments and those type of things. Thanks.
Thank you. I think Phil.
Thank you, Chairwoman Galef, Chairman Breslin. It's a privilege to be here on behalf of the Assembly Minority Conference to talk about some of the proposals we think should be a priority in these budget negotiations. A few weeks ago, our conference had a press conference highlighting some of those proposals. One of those proposals is to make the property tax cap permanent and including New York City in the property tax cap. The governor has made very clear that he's not going to sign a budget without the property tax cap in it. We were pleased to see that the Senate included that measure in their budget. We would like to continue to advocate for that in the final budget. We believe also unfunded mandate relief needs to be a priority for our municipalities. Our policy is quite simple. If we're passing it, we should be paying for it. It's evident with what happened with the early voting and some of those election reform proposals that were passed. We think that needs to be addressed. And certainly on the Medicaid program, it continues to be the biggest burden out there for our localities. We need to continue to have a discussion about that from a long-term perspective on how the state can assume more of those costs, because that's a burden for our local property taxpayers. We were pleased that both majorities rejected the governor's cut to the AIM funding and asking the counties to pay for it with another mandate. We agree that that's and support that as well. We continue to support a spending cap. We think we believe it's not a revenue problem that our state has, it's a spending problem. We think by having a spending cap in place that will help in future legislatures moving forward and making sure our budgets are always fiscally sound. We fully support both majorities' calls to reject the governor's proposal relative to freezing the STAR growth and income limitations. We think that was the right move by both majorities. We are full support of that, and hopefully that continues to move forward in the budget negotiations. One other issue I'd like to briefly mention, although I know it's not in our purview here specifically, but it does affect local municipalities, is the call I would ask us to continue to advocate to our leadership in both houses about to increase CHIPS funding. I know the Senate One House budget had $150 million increase in the CHIPS base aid. We were pleased to see that. I know both budgets had the winter recovery money restoration, but we do believe the CHIPS base aid should be a part of that discussion. We believe it's warranted. It's been flat for 7 years, and we were going to continue to call for an increase in the CHIPS base aid that benefits every part of the state, New York City, Long Island, and upstate New York. And every dollar we invest in the CHIPS program is one less dollar that comes from the local property taxpayer. So those are some of the priorities we'll continue to advocate and encourage my colleagues and the chairwoman and chairman to advocate for these things as we move forward in the budget negotiations. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Phil. You have a long list, but they're not all on this table. So, you know, thinking about tax caps and everything, I think that's in, I believe that's probably on the mothership, probably. But we take into account all the things that you've talked about. And certainly, I think all of us, many of us have come from local governments, and, you know, I think we are concerned about adopting anything that has a tremendous impact on our local governments. So, you know, we're very conscious of that. But also at the same time, you know, there are new programs and there are new ways of doing things, like elections, that we want to be sure we go forward with new concepts. So it's always a problem back and forth. And yes, the STAR is in our area, and I'm glad that we both recognized trying to continue the growth in the STAR program, which impacts so many of us in a very positive way with our taxpayers. So we will do an analysis as we go forward of the Assembly and Senate and exactly where we are meshing and where we have some different ideas, and we go forward, looking forward to resolving all these issues on this table.
I couldn't agree more. We haven't yet received a table target, but there's ongoing conversations between and among us. And as you can see, there are a number of different agencies that are part of this process. So stay tuned. So with that, unless we don't have a gavel, but would anyone else like to have a closing remark? Senator Gorin.
Well, I just want to say I concur with a lot that has been said, and the restoration of AIM, I'm pleased that the Assembly has joined us with that, and I look forward to working with all my colleagues, including making sure we have funding for the early voting, the other electoral reforms, and everything else that we need to do.
Thank you, Senator Gorin. With that, we'll accept a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. We're adjourned.
Adjourn.
Thank you.
It's good to see you, Steve. Hey, good to see you. We're in a different room.